For thousands of years, King Tut was little more than a footnote, a minor pharaoh who died before he could leave his mark. But today, the boy king reigns supreme. In pop culture, he has become virtually synonymous with ancient Egypt, eclipsing his far more accomplished predecessors. And that is largely thanks to the 1922 discovery of Tut's treasure-filled tomb. While greater kings had their burials plundered right away, Tut was so undervalued that within a few years of his death, he was all but forgotten. But once his tomb was found, a legend was born. From the moment they were first uncovered, the treasures of King Tut have captivated the world, overshadowing Tut himself. But what can the riches he left behind teach us about the boy king? Now, on the 100th anniversary of the discovery of his tomb, Tut's treasures are being transferred to a state-of-the-art new museum in the shadow of the pyramids. But before they're moved, famed Egyptologist Zahi Hawass has gained special access to examine them at the Old Cairo Museum. For Zahi, this is a golden opportunity to look for details other experts might have missed.
The burial of Tutankhamun contained 5,398 objects. It's like a story. It tells us a lot about the life of Tutankhamun.
So the race is on to re-examine these precious artifacts and uncover new clues about the life of King Tut, along with answers to some of history's most persistent questions. Why did he turn against the religion of his father? Was he a mere pawn of his advisors, or a mighty king in his own right? And most mysteriously, how did King Tut die? To learn the truth, Zahi will need to look at more than Tut's treasures. He and his team will cast their net across Egypt, investigating spectacular temples, lost palaces, and long-forgotten tombs that hold unexpected secrets about the golden boy king. Finally, a full picture of the man behind the treasure can be revealed as we explore 100 years of myth and unearth 3,000-year-old secrets from the life of Tutankhamun. Since the discovery of his tomb by Howard Carter in November 1922, the boy king, Tutankhamun, has been a mystery that refuses to be solved.
I think a lot of people think they know who Tutankhamun was, but actually his backstory is very mysterious and very, very debated.
Most people believe Tut was the incestuous offspring of King Akhenaten and one of his sisters. This could explain why Tut suffered from multiple abnormalities, including difficulty walking. He died under mysterious circumstances around the age of 18 or 19, and was buried in a tiny tomb that nevertheless contained a king's ransom in treasure.
Here he was with a beautiful gilded golden mask that everyone looked at and thought this must have been someone really, really important.
This golden mask is an exquisite piece of craftsmanship, but this face may be all that people know about the golden boy king. But it is also a potent symbol for the myth we have built around King Tut. The mask is a facade, beautiful, enigmatic, but ultimately unreadable.
This is the most beautiful object ever seen in my life. Look at the face, the round chin, the wide eyes. It is shining with the sun, as if it's telling me now in hieroglyphic, I'm the golden boy. This is a public face that everyone recognizes, but to know about Tutankhamun as a boy, as a man, as a king, to know his personality, we have to go and see other objects found in the tomb.
These objects are important because the contents of the tomb were found completely intact, just as they were left 3,300 years ago.
Most ancient Egyptian tombs, when discovered, are found empty, or maybe with just scraps left in there. They were robbed in ancient times.
Tut's tomb is regarded as the only such burial to have escaped plunder. Or did it? An examination of the sealed doorways found by Howard Carter tells a different story.
As soon as Carter looked at the sealed doorway of the tomb, he realized it had been opened and then closed again in the past. He could see the original ceilings from the burial, then he could see two further sets of seal impressions where the holes had been blocked up by the necropolis guards.
When Howard Carter saw those seals, he knew he had found something special. But what exactly did they tell him?
This is what I'm looking for. The seals that Howard Carter found at the entrance of the tomb. First of all, he read the name Tutankhamun. Then he was sure that he found the tomb that he was looking for. 6 years of research and excavation. The tomb is completely intact. Big day.
Those seals also tell us that the necropolis guards, responsible for protecting the contents of Tut's tomb, stopped it from being robbed not once, but twice. Each time a seal was broken, the necropolis guards resealed the chamber to prevent looting. Without those seals, there would be no artifacts left to discover, and no legend of King Tut to explore. The guards had done their job, but now the tomb was in the hands of Howard Carter.
Carter then created a hole in that sealed wall, thinking when he looked through, he'd just see a mess. But as his eyes grew accustomed to the light, all he could see was the glitter of gold. And he was asked over his shoulder, "Can you see anything?" And he says, "Yes, I see wonderful things."
Those wonderful things are a window into not just the young pharaoh, but everyday life in ancient Egypt. That's because, to the Egyptians, the afterlife was more than just an abstract concept. It's the reason their tombs were packed full of treasures in the first place.
The ancient Egyptians believed that all the things you brought in your tomb, you would have had in the afterlife.
And that does imply that there is a belief that you could take it with you, that these things were there to allow you to furnish your home in the next world in the way you'd furnished yours in this world.
Of course, certain items could have been just symbolic, but there are some elements that most likely Tutankhamun or, in general, ancient Egyptian pharaohs would have chosen for themselves.
We have things in there that he used in life, that he cherished, and this can tell us a lot about him as a person and how he lived.
One item tucked away in the antechamber sheds new light on Tut's personal life. It has long been assumed that Tut was forced into an incestuous and loveless marriage to his sister Ankhesenamun, an alliance designed to save a crumbling dynasty by keeping the royal bloodline pure. This beautiful golden throne tells a different story. The crowds who flock to see it may not even notice the intimate code engraved into its exquisite artwork. It's only up close, with the glass removed, that the true nature of the couple's relationship is revealed.
I am going to tell you a love story. This love story happened 3,000 years ago between a young king and a young queen, Tutankhamun and his beautiful queen, Ankhesenamun. Look, the way that Ankhesenamun touching the shoulder of the boy was love and affection. She's offering him oil, maybe to make his face beautiful. This is love. But the other important evidence is unique. On Tutankhamun's left leg, there is one sandal only. Nothing in the right one. On the right leg of the queen, there is one sandal. This is actually a sign that they are one person and are in love.
The symbols of the couple's love for one another are not the only secrets the throne hides in plain sight. For example, most people only know Tut by one name, Tutankhamun. But that's not the name he was born with.
One of the most important secrets about this throne, it proves it was made on the first year of the reign of Tutankhamun, because the name in the cartouche, Tutankhaton, the living image of Aton.
Tutankhaton is the name Tut had when he took the throne. A few years later, though, the young king changed it to Tutankhamun. To uncover his motivation, Egyptologist Alia Ismail has traveled more than 200 miles north of Luxor to the remote region of Amarna. There, she is searching for a key piece of evidence from the controversial reign of Tut's father, Akhenaten, one that might explain why the boy king would go even further than just changing his name, to betray his father completely and change Egypt forever. On a temple wall in Abydos, one of the oldest cities in ancient Egypt, there is a famous inscription called the King's List, commissioned by the 19th dynasty pharaoh, Seti I. It honors 76 pharaohs who ruled Egypt before him, going back over 1,000 years. But notably missing from the list are two of his predecessors, King Tut and Tut's father, Akhenaten. Why? Why would these two pharaohs be excluded? What could they have done to be deliberately erased from history? The answer lies in Amarna.
Wow. This is the boundary stela of Akhenaten. He erected these stelas as a boundary for the city that he's erecting in his fifth year of reign.
Akhenaten forced a move of the capital city from Thebes to here, Amarna, a location over 200 miles away. These inscribed stones, or stela, describe Akhenaten's reasons for choosing this area, an upheaval which sparked widespread outrage. Thebes, known today as Luxor, was then the center of worship for Amun-Ra, considered the supreme god in ancient Egypt, representing both fertility and war. Akhenaten instead built his new city to exclusively worship the sun god Aten.
The Aten started off its existence well before Akhenaten's time as simply a word for the physical body of the sun. And then what Akhenaten does is actually promotes the Aten to being a fully fledged god, and not only that, but the only god he is prepared to worship.
To most ancient Egyptians, this was little short of heresy. It also upset the established order of the god Amun-Ra, whose priests now had to lurk in the great temples at Thebes, waiting for Akhenaten to die. His edict enforcing the exclusive worship of the Aten would have a profound effect on young Tutankhaten, who would begin his own reign earlier than anyone expected. Akhenaten died 17 years into his tumultuous rule. It's debated whether his wife, Queen Nefertiti, outlived him or not. The latest known image of her is dated to 5 years before his death. Replacing them as leader of Egypt was Akhenaten's 9-year-old son, Tutankhamun. Ultimately, the mummies of both royals, as well as their capital city, disappeared from history. But what happened to Akhenaten and Nefertiti? Dr. Zahi Hawass has been on the hunt for their mummies for years. In 2010, he turned his attention to three mummies from Tut's era, the 18th dynasty, found in temporary tombs in the Valley of the Kings. Zahi speculated that the skeleton of a mummified male from a tomb referred to as KV-55, which had its face violently hacked off in ancient times, could be Tut's father. To determine any genetic connection to Tutankhamun, Zahi arranged for DNA tests to be conducted to compare the genomes from these mummies with that of both Tut and his grandfather, Amenhotep III.
Who is the father of King Tut.
Here, Zahi receives the results he's been waiting for.
We show you who is the father of King Tut. So this DNA, which is labeled in blue, is transmitted from the father to the son. And they're all identical. You know, AV55, the mummy of...
is the father of Tutankhamun.
Yes, exactly.
I'm very happy.
For Zahi, the DNA test proves that the badly preserved male mummy was none other than Tut's father and son of Amenhotep III, the heretic pharaoh Akhenaten. But not every scholar agrees that the man found in tomb KV-55 is Akhenaten.
It's almost impossible that he can be Akhenaten. A number of reasons. First of all is the age at death. The vast majority of anatomists who've examined the body have proclaimed him to be in his 20s, which is far too young to be Akhenaten.
The team working with Zahi points to other evidence. They believe a close examination of the bones suggests an older age.
With age, the discs will lose their heights, and then bones will react with formation of small spicules of bones, what we call the osteophytes. And it's quite apparent in the spine here that we have many of these osteophytes. For sure, it cannot be a 20 or 20-something age group.
Those who dispute Zahi's findings believe that the mummy may be an enigmatic royal called Smenkhare, who reigned briefly as a co-pharaoh in the last years of Akhenaten's rule.
My view, and again there are various views around, is that Smenkhare was Akhenaten's brother. He died some years prior to the end of Akhenaten's reign, having been co-regent for perhaps only a year or two.
If Smenkhare was the brother of Akhenaten, then genetically he could be the mummy in KV-55.
They would share the same DNA, so therefore it would make a difference to the overall DNA situation.
Others believe Smenkhare was a brother not of Akhenaten, but of Tut himself. More evidence is needed to find out if Tut was the only male heir. And to find that evidence, more scrutiny is needed at Amarna, the capital city Akhenaten founded.
We're at the small Aten temple now. And these Aten temples were the reason this city was erected in the first place. For Akhenaten to show the strong relationship between himself and the god Aten, there would have been a lot of depictions of the royal family through statuary and through paintings.
Despite the information that survived on the city's stone markers, nothing here depicts the entirety of Akhenaten's family. In an act of defiance against his dead father, he not only changed his name from Tutankhaten, stripping out the sun god Aten's name, he restored the worship of Amun-Ra and abandoned Amarna, which was later destroyed. Though some artifacts remain, others must be sought.
When the whole Atenist experiment came to an end, the buildings at Amarna were demolished, and the blocks taken across the river to Ashmunain to be used in the foundations of structures constructed by later kings.
It was feared that the blocks would be lost forever until Zahi tracked one down across the Nile from Amarna in a warehouse beside the ruins of Ashmunain. What was written on it was a revelation.
In Chet F, Merit F, Tut Ankh-Atun.
King's son, of his body, his beloved Tutankhaten.
The king on the Ashmunain blocks is almost certainly going to be Akhenaten, but he's the only male king who appears anywhere on the blocks from Ashmunain.
This is very important evidence that King Tut is the son of Akhenaten.
It's certain that this tableau was in one of the Aten temples.
And crucially, Tut is the only son mentioned, suggesting that he was indeed the only male heir to Akhenaten. So, the desecration of Akhenaten's face, as well as the dismantling of his religion and the destruction of his capital city, may all have been the acts of the young king who changed his name to Tutankhamun. There is, however, someone else who was frequently depicted with Akhenaten, his now much more famous wife, Nefertiti. If Tut's father can be confirmed as the ragged mummy found in the Valley of the Kings, could the nearby female mummy be his great royal wife, Nefertiti? And was Nefertiti actually Tut's mother? You may not have heard of Akhenaten, but you've certainly heard of his powerful wife, Nefertiti. An unfinished sculpture of the queen has made her the most famous face of antiquity, the ultimate icon of ancient beauty. The bust itself is also one of the most hotly contested artifacts in the world. You see, Nefertiti is no longer in Egypt. Since 1924, she's been housed in Germany, where millions of visitors to the Berlin Museum have bought tickets to see history's most beautiful woman. She was taken underground during World War II for safekeeping, and in the 70s came to represent national identities on both sides of the Berlin Wall. She even appeared on a postage stamp in West Germany in 1989. Yet, as Germany continues to claim her, Egyptian authorities have been struggling for decades to repatriate Nefertiti back to her homeland. So, the battle for the great queen continues, with neither side appearing to let up anytime soon. In honor of the 100th anniversary of the discovery of King Tut's tomb, Zahi Hawass has again gathered his DNA research team to further investigate the 18th dynasty mummies found in the Valley of the Kings. Could the mummy be the famous queen Nefertiti?
Dr. Yahya, the work that you did is incredible, and this is why...
The investigation reveals that the mummy shares the same DNA as Tut, and almost certainly was his mother. And considering that Tut's father was married to Nefertiti, we're left with two important questions. Is Tut's mother Nefertiti? And could this be her mummy? To understand that, we have to dive deeper into the mummy's DNA. The genetic signature from the mummy indicates that, along with being Tut's mother, she is also either the sister of Tut's father or his father's first cousin. Since historians widely hold that Nefertiti was Akhenaten's cousin, this is an important genetic mystery to solve. With speculation swirling, Zahi seeks further clarity from his DNA team.
Dr. Yahya, if there is any possible circumstances that we can think that the younger lady in KV 35 could be a cousin, not a sister, of Akhenaten.
A kinship analysis getting a result with 99.99 negates the possibility of being other than the daughter of Queen T and Amenhotep.
For sure. Yes, okay.
If this analysis is correct, it means that despite Tut's father being married to Nefertiti, Tut himself is the incestuous offspring of his father and his father's unnamed sister. And depictions of Tut's father with Nefertiti and her children do seem to support this conclusion. Nowhere is a male child visible, only six daughters. In Tut's own tomb, no siblings of any kind are represented.
If you look at old art at that time, it seemed that he was not depicted with his sisters.
And in that, it follows thousands of years of Egyptian precedent, because again, when you show the royal family, you never ever show royal princes.
But Akhenaten clearly had no problem breaking with precedent. He did, after all, include Tut on the Amarna block found in Ashmenean. So why exclude Prince Tut from the paintings?
God knows. But that's the whole point. It changes. In the latter years of Akhenaten, he'd make the decision to do something no pharaoh has ever done before, which is to put his son on a temple wall.
This leads you to think that he might have not been a son of Nefertiti, but from a secondary wife of Akhenaten. And that's why he wouldn't have been depicted.
So, if Tut was not one of Nefertiti's children, then the identity of his mother remains a mystery. According to Zahi, since she doesn't appear in any inscriptions, it's likely that she died early, perhaps in childbirth. To confirm this theory, Zahi travels across the Nile from Amarna to the burial fields of Saqqara. Here, he enters a recently opened tomb, which has been stabilized with supports to prevent collapse. He's searching for a unique piece of evidence, which could prove that King Tut was raised without any mother at all. King Tut was buried in the historic Valley of the Kings, but this royal cemetery was only in use for a few hundred years during Egypt's new kingdom. Far older and populated with far more mummies is the necropolis of Saqqara. I've been there many times, and I have to say one of my favorite sights is the Serapeum, because, well, it's so unusual, you have to love it. It's a crypt full of oversized coffins, each one for a sacred bull. High priests of the Apis cult that worshipped the god Ptah would scour Egypt looking for a bull that had just the right pattern of spots on its back. Once found, the bull was venerated, and upon its death, buried in the Serapeum. Over the ages, at least 70 coffins were added. You've got to wonder what went through archaeologists' minds when they opened the stone tombs expecting to find a mountain of gold. Instead, gazing back at them was a herd of mummified steer. The lesson here? When history gets weird, you just have to embrace it. Saqqara, Egypt's city of the dead. Zahi Hawass has come to visit a tomb that may provide further confirmation that Tut's mother was not Queen Nefertiti. In fact, depictions here show Tut raised as a motherless child.
We are looking at a unique scene for a lady. Her name is Mia. She had a unique title, the Lady of the Harem. And she was the one who nursed the god. And the god here means Tutankhamun. What is in the wall to tell us that the one who's seated on the lap of Mia is Tutankhamun is the cartouche, Neb Khibru Ra, the throne name of Tutankhamun.
The tomb was damaged in antiquity, destroying half of the image.
But we can imagine 3,000 years ago how it looked like. Very colorful. This is a very unique image. We never see a scene like this with any king of Dynasty 18 or the new kingdom in general. It shows that he had no mother, and Mia became the mother and the witness of the king because she's very proud to say about herself, I nursed the god, and the god meant Tutankhamun. I really believe that Tutankhamun, we can see from the scenes of him and his queen, love and affection. Maybe the man did learn love from Mia, because Mia, look at her face. She's looking at him with love, her right hand touching him with love, and the boy king grew up with love.
So, Tut grew up with Queen Nefertiti not as his mother, but his stepmother. She would share responsibility for decisions in his personal life, and one key to her own personal safety, his marriage to one of her daughters.
Tutankhamun later on marries his sister, Akhsenpa'aten. It seemed that Nefertiti was trying to line up the girls for the throne.
You have a situation where Akhenaten and Nefertiti were left with no male heirs. So not having a male heir kind of puts Nefertiti in a position where she's thinking, how do I make sure that we stay royal in a situation where Akhenaten, who was behind this revolution, suddenly has disappeared? So it could have been from a desire to grant her and her daughters more security, but it could have been also the most logical and practical step to take.
It would appear that the queen wished to set up a rule that would protect her and continue the revolution started by her husband. But Nefertiti would not be the only influence on young Tut. Egyptologist Aliyah Ismail is in a remote region of the Nile at a town called Akhmim to explore the tomb of a man who may have directed young Tut to betray his father's legacy.
Wow. Finally. This tomb has been carved out in the rock in the middle of nowhere. It would have been put up here so that it's probably out of reach. And for sure, the individual who owned this tomb was very rich and of high status because he would afford to have a tomb carved in stone all the way up here. It says that it belongs to overseer of tutors, Sen Nejem. And overseer of tutors was no ordinary title. It was actually referring to him being the highest rank of tutors and therefore the tutor of the king.
This is the forgotten tomb of a man called Senajem. And as Aaliyah is about to discover, Senajem had a uniquely privileged position, which gave him access to the king.
If we look close, because it's a little faded out, we can see an image of a king on a chariot. And that king is probably Tutankhamun. But right in front of the king's face, we can see an arc. And that arc represents a fan. And if there is a fan, there has to be someone holding that fan and fanning the king. And in that case, we're going to assume that this person is Sen Nejem. But this is not just a dull assumption. This is referring to the title that he actually mentions on the lintel, which says fan bearer to the king. And being the fan bearer of the king means basically you were stuck to the king. And if you were stuck to the king, then you have the king's ear.
This puts Senajem in a very influential situation.
If the king is learning from you, he's looking up to you, that means you're spoon-feeding him what you want him to feel, believe, and know about Egypt.
But would a tutor be so bold as to manipulate the entire future of Egypt? Or was he working with other, more powerful forces? King Tut was not yet 10 when he became pharaoh, a shockingly young age to lead a nation. But he's not the youngest child to ascend to a throne. Isengiro Puyi became the last emperor of China at age 2. And Mary, Queen of Scots, became a national leader when she was just 6 days old. Both rulers lived much longer lives than Tut, but neither enjoyed the same royal send-off at their deaths. Mary was thrown into prison by her rival, Elizabeth I, and was beheaded at age 44. Puyi was replaced after 4 years and lived a tumultuous life in and out of power, ultimately dying at age 61 as a commoner in 1967. Tut's lifespan was much shorter, but ultimately much more productive. He changed a religion, restored a capital city, and today he's known as the most famous pharaoh of all time. King Tut took the throne under the name his father gave him, Tutankhaten, which honored the god of the sun, Aten. But we know him as Tutankhamun, honoring the god of war and fertility, Amun. How quickly after his ascension did this change of allegiance take place? One clue lies in the Cairo Museum, with one of the most enigmatic depictions of Tut to emerge from his tomb.
Beautiful face. Look at the oval shape. It's wonderful. Something very elegant.
Here, Tut is shown as a young boy, suggesting this statue was made early in his reign. A close look at the shape of his crown suggests that he may have already switched allegiance from Aten to Amun by this time.
Look at the hat. It's rounded. But also, it is a typical type of a crown of the god Amun that we see it everywhere. If you take the cobra out, you will think that Tutankhamun united himself with Amun.
So, the hat itself represents a switch from the worship of Aten to the worship of Amun, and a reversal of everything that Akhenaten would have hoped his son Tut would represent. But the hat was the least of his betrayal. Back in Thebes, Tut also returned the Temple of Karnak to the priesthood of Amun. Here, at the 10th pylon gate of Karnak, is decisive evidence that Tut completely rejected his father Akhenaten and his legacy.
We are in pylon number 10, which was built by Amenhotep III. And you can see this avenue of the Sphinxes is a part of the big avenue of the Sphinxes that connecting the Temple of Karnak to the Temple of Luxor.
For millennia, a double line of ram-headed sphinxes representing the god Amun flanked the route all the way to the Luxor Temple. But in the time of the Aten, all that changed. When Akhenaten came to power, he tore down the statues representing Amun and replaced them with images of himself and his great royal wife Nefertiti. The Avenue of the Sphinxes became the Avenue of the Aten. Until Tutankhamun.
Tutankhamun came and took this head out and put the head of Amun as ram.
Tut replaced the head of his father with the head of the god whom Akhenaten had rejected. It was a complete betrayal of all that Akhenaten had stood for and an unmistakable declaration from the new king.
What we see everywhere, he's trying to tell the people, I'm worshiping Amun. I'm restoring the country to be back to power.
But why would the boy who was named for the Aten turn his back on his father's religion so quickly and with such finality? The answer lies back in the crowded halls of the Cairo Museum, where a gigantic stone tablet details the sins of Akhenaten that a young Tut set out to write.
The restoration stela of Tutankhamun is very important for us to understand the time and the life of Tutankhamun. This is telling us what happened to the temples. The temples were in ruin. The gods of Egypt left Egypt. The country collapsed. What he did, he began to restore the temples. I gave statues of gold to the temple of Amun at Karnak. I gave the priests all the wealth that they need. Means the country came to power again under Amun. And Tutankhamun is declaring this to all of us.
This decision changed the course of Egyptian history. But most experts believe that Tut did not make it on his own.
It's important to recognize that Tutankhamun probably had very little to do with any of the decisions here. He was a child, he was just a subject of a regency. And therefore, he would have had to go really along with what his regents were telling him to do.
This approximately 10-year-old child who's in charge of one of the most powerful countries in the world at a time when Egypt was experiencing this many difficulties. And perhaps at the suggestion of one of his courtiers, maybe I, that maybe all of this is because of Akhenaten's religious changes.
It seems likely that at the start of his reign, the young King Tut was surrounded by adults telling him what to do. Key among them was a family member named Ai, who proclaimed himself to be Tut's advisor.
Tutankhamun was a boy. He cannot think to worship Aten or Amun. But his advisor, Ai, was the one who took him and advised him to leave Amarna and come to Thebes and return the image of Amun again.
I was a minor member of the royal family by marriage and inserted himself as one of the most prominent figures in the young king's court. And he had a clear agenda to have Tut bring back the old religion. Tut had another formidable advisor, Horemheb, the commander of the king's army who had no royal blood. But it was I who was able to exert the most influence through his association with Tut's tutor, Senegem.
When this tomb was erected, I was the main advisor of Tutankhamun. So I surrounded Tutankhamun with people from his team. So basically, Senegem, in this role as fan bearer and overseer of tutors, was the voice of I inside the king's ear.
And that's why the decision was made in that time by I. And he made this propaganda to tell the Egyptians that Amun power was back.
Most historians believe the return to worship of Amun happened in the first years of King Tut's reign. But as is often the case with ancient history, contradictions have been uncovered. Zahi has special permission to inspect the royal symbols unique to Tut's reign, known as crooks and flails.
You know, there is six crooks and flails found inside the tomb of Tutankhamun. But what's amazing, if you look at these two, one is a small one and one is a big one. When Tutankhamun was a child in year one, lived in Amarna, he had this crook as a child. Why? Because his name is written as Tutankhatun, means the living image of Aten. But when he grew up and he became a man, he wanted to prove to the Egyptians, I am the power. I am the king of Upper and Lower Egypt. And he changed his name here to be Tutankhamun, means the living image of Amun.
So this tells us that King Tutankhamun would have made this significant move back to traditional religion sometime in his early teens, such that when he was adult-sized, he had a normal-sized crook and flail with the name Tutankhamun.
Whether or not Tut changed his name right away, he appears to have embraced the return to worship of Amun completely. He not only restored the Temple of Karnak in Luxor, but the majestic Luxor Temple itself. This center of the cult of Amun on the banks of the River Nile had been stripped of its power by Akhenaten. But Tut embraced it and would make his support public during one of the most important religious festivals of the year, the Opet Feast.